Well, really, I don't need to have a presentation. I just wanted to get all y'all in a room together because I think if you just had conversations, we could tell the story of the Wild Basin through your own story. So thank you for all being here. As Ellen said, my name is Jennifer Bristol, and Mom and I are working on this book together. And when we started revisiting this project, it was like telling the story of our beginnings for our life through conservation and how we wanted to, you know, kind of our roadmap of getting started for so many things. So I'm going to talk a little bit about kind of our journey and then tell some of the story of the Wild Basin. It has a long, long history. It would be hard to cram it all into one talk. It's going to be hard to cram it into even one, you know, single document, but we're going to certainly try and do it justice in our book as that comes forward. We are still in the process of writing the book. We're still in the process of interviewing women around the state. There are amazing women across the state who are doing things from conserving wildlife to land, to water, you name it, even in the field of social justice and seeing how nature is a health strategy for us. So I'd say we're probably about halfway done through our interviews. We started in East Texas and we're working our way across the state. And as Mom knows, I love a good list. I love a good spreadsheet. And so things have to fit in those that category as we move across the state. And I think that's something that I certainly loved about Martha and these ladies is they made good lists. I've enjoyed looking at their lists. So, just a little bit about Mom and I. So, I'm going to start, you know, every project has a story. And I'm going to start with my story, which kind of started right on this property. We lived right around the corner. I played on this piece of property. There was a tree out back, an elm tree that I would climb a lot. This was a dirt road. This was a horse pasture. Next door, there was a horse. I knew where all the horses were in Westlake. And I had one of my own. This is Squaw. I did not name her. Forgive the name. She was a pony of America, and she would do anything I asked. She was an amazing pony. And I'm sorry that Pat Reeves is not here, one of our neighbors, including riding her into Pat's living room. as you can see, you know, this is probably about 1976, 77. I was six years old when I got her. Nobody else really liked to ride her. She was a little willful, a little stubborn, but she was a dream in the show ring and amazing on the trails. And Mom would walk, so the stables was right, it was on Bee Caves Road, where 360 is now, and Bee Caves Road, the old Johnson property that was there. And there was a stables that was there. And so we could walk up and over the hill and down into the Wild Basin. And we explored the creeks, we walked the trails, of course the beautiful waterfall was always something we stopped and looked at. And I have such a memory of that place. The smell of the caliche when they were blasting through the rock. I can smell the way the water was in different seasons. The intensity of the cedars during the fall. There's such a memory of that place. In the creek bed, there was wagon trails. Or they looked like what were wagon ruts in there. And of course, then there was some story that blended in my mind about the moonshine stills that were back there, and you know, I love telling my nephew all kinds of great stories about that kind of thing because that dazzles him. So we would ride back there. Mom was always willing to take a long hike. It was not something short, certainly on a hot summer day. And then at the end of it, she would let us go. And my pony would pretty much trot or gallop the entire way back. She knew the way, I knew the way. Sometimes I fell off, I had to, you know, walk back. But on one occasion, It's a little bit later in the 70s. They were starting to blast through the cut through. And Squaw decided she had enough of that and took off and ran back to the barn on her own, leaving me, a 7 or 8 year old child, probably pretty disgruntled that I had to walk back now up the steep hill. And we got back, it was night when we got back. And Squaw had already let herself into the tack room and is getting her own dinner out. So when I say she was a willful pony, she was very willful. But so that was the beginning of our connection with that. And soon when Mom came across an opportunity to volunteer to help raise some money, that was a no-brainer. We loved the place. You know, it was right here in our own backyard, and so we did. We sat out front of Rylander's. I had a little can, a Folgers coffee can that I had decorated with yarn and all kinds of things, and we stood out there and would ask people for money as they came out of the grocery store, and, you know, I always loved the sound of change going in there, but I also liked the sound of a dollar. And it was exciting. It felt like a win. You know, if we got even just a few dollars gathered up that day, that was remarkable. And it was a total win. Now, in full disclosure, that is not the last time that I've asked for people for money for conservation effort, but it was certainly the first. And maybe I perfected those skills on that day. I don't know. But so fast forward, you know, why were there kids out shaking a can in front of Rylander's grocery store? And if y'all don't know where Rylander's grocery store is, most of y'all in this room do, but it's where the Walgreens is. That was the little grocery store that was there. And owned by the Rylanders. They own a number of other things in town as well. But the reason we were out there was because of seven amazing women who had a vision, who could see the changes coming and wanted to preserve our natural heritage. And I loved from A Snowball's Chance in Hell, which is a book that Janet Cove wrote. It was never published, but it's copyrighted and it's written. But she described each one of the women, and I think it several of the descriptions are very apropos, and I certainly wish I would have known more of them. So Willa Mae Hardesty was the co-keeper of the cache. Apparently she could fix anything, had a home, a master's in home economics, and was a fabulous lobbyist in the terms of she could convince people to do pretty much whatever she was asking them to do. Martha Hudson was, who is here today, president of Now or Never. She was on the school board, a recruiter extraordinaire, and often described in your own words, as well as Janet's, as the tether to ground Janet sometimes to make sure she didn't get too far into the stratosphere. Margaret Hessen was a registered nurse, a stickler for Robert's Rules of Order, and a stalker. At one point, she tracked down Henry H. Butts all the way down to Corpus Christi to secure a donation from him. And so stalker is my term, not Janet's, but it certainly sounded like she was out to make sure that he was going to give something. Flo Macklin, unfortunately, who couldn't be here today, described herself as the foot soldier. She had a BS, and I love this, retail merchandising for women only. I don't think they have that degree anymore, but I love that she did. Extremely dependable, as how everybody described her, and quiet in her opinion, but when she had it, everybody listened. Esther, and I love the second name, Wargo. She also was an RN and an instructor in medical surgical nursing, which was pretty cool, I thought, and an extraordinary environmental educator, and fell in love with nature along the way. Janet Pope was the cheerleader, chairman of the Westlake Hills Zoning and Planning and a fabulous strategist. I would say she was pretty remarkable even as public relations and marketing as well. Lucilla was a the other co-keeper of the cache and executive secretary, and has some of the most beautiful handwriting I've ever seen. She seems like she was very organized and was, along with Willa May, keeping records of that cache, and who gave a donation was extremely, extremely important to them. And so Janet goes on to describe them as two retired school teachers, two retired nurses, a secretary, two retired military wives, a whole mess of children, and little old ladies in tennis shoes out to save the Wild Basin. You know, I love that because they were at odds with some really big development that was coming pretty quick. And because of their tenacity and willingness not to take no for an answer, they succeeded. So where did it begin? So those of y'all that moved here in the 70s, we'll go back to 1972. And it kind of started with a woman named Nancy Bowman. I mean, Martha can correct me if I'm wrong here, but she went to a junior league meeting, and it was all about conservation and preserving parts of land and communities that you love. And she was on fire. And she came back and she gathered her friends together and told them about what she had learned and what other women were doing around the state and some of the projects that were going on. And in particular, preserving the rural heritage, which was an important key in here. They were further inspired by presentation that they also went to by Sinclair Black, who is a fabulous architect here in Austin and has done amazing things. And he's a wonderful naturalist as well, and he gave a presentation on the watersheds in Travis County. And he had photographs of the waterfall on the creek. And they loved that. They were like, this is right in our own backyard. You know, nature isn't something far, far away that we can ascertain and preserve and keep. It doesn't have to be the Rocky Mountains. It doesn't have to be, you know, down on the coastline. It's right here, and it's beautiful, and it's sensational, and it's worth keeping. So they formed Now or Never, and this is interesting in itself. A lot of the women that we've looked at, they've worked through organizations that were already formed. These bold ladies formed their own group, and they called it Now or Never. Again, an amazing term. It immediately catches your attention. It says, we gotta take action right now. What are you doing? What does this mean? Tell me more about it. And in their vision, I love this statement, protect the rural way of life and natural beauty and the promotion of good land use planning. So those were kind of their original goals that were in there. They talk about natural beauty. And I want to talk about beautification projects a little bit here. Going all the way back to the 1920s, if women wanted to do something in their community that was for nature, it was kind of the man's world, but if they were doing a beautification project, it was totally fine. You do whatever you want. Knock yourselves out, raise the money, get it done, and they did. The garden clubs across America, they were out beautifying things when they say the Trident Prairie. They got lands down on the Gulf Coast side for bird habitat. You know, they're out beautifying things under this term. And even as Lady Bird Johnson comes forward and into when her husband, Lyndon, becomes president, she was safe as long as she was doing Beautification Act. And the Highways Beautification Act has that term in there for a reason. It was palatable. It was easy to say, okay, yes, this is something that we can get behind, and it's not hardcore environmentalism. You know, it's beautification. It's soft, but it's beautiful and it's nice. So, they played on that some, but then eventually they didn't need to at all. I mention that because something else was going on in Austin. This is the Palmer Auditorium Center and the Coliseum there, up at the top, the railroad that comes across. And that big scar is what later becomes Auditorium Shores. The very first project that they got together and put down there under the Town Lake Beautification Project was the Women in Construction Gazebo. And if y'all remember, it's kind of that unusual looking sweeping thing that was down there. And this was a project by another group of women. That was Lady Bird Johnson, Roberta Crenshaw, and Ann Butler, who saw this and wanted to do their own beautification project, especially as we're coming forward to 1976, which was the bicentennial. And there was lots of these projects kind of moving along as we moved towards that marker. So I love looking at this picture. As you can see, the cypress trees aren't down there. The trees that we see now that are all down there, they weren't there at that time. It was pre-start up. They had this huge construction project for the Palmer Event Center. Across the way, you can't see it very well, but that Sea Home power plant that's there. And then there's not much else going on as you go up the creek there. But they had put in Longhorn Dam shortly before that, and then that's what created the lake. And so that's what they were looking at is, how do we turn this into something usable? How do we make this a natural experience for people in this downtown area? And so they wanted the hike and bike trail and then all of the beautification that went along with that. When I say beautification, they planted a lot of trees. So change was coming. And in Austin, there were three major road projects that were happening. And once those were filed, it didn't take long for people's imaginations to realize those neighborhoods were coming. You described at Lost Creek that you were there, and it was one of the early developments. And things were happening in the development world that was very new and different at this time period, that radically changed how the neighborhoods were built. They would come in, especially if they were unincorporated county, bulldoze down everything. There was no tree ordinances, they didn't need to keep them. Bulldoze down everything. Put your houses up, one of 10 designs, right? Very quickly, because they had pre-designed everything. You could put those things up really quick, not to probably the best building practices, maybe. But some of them are still here. I know ours was recently torn down right around the corner. So that was happening all across the nation. It took a little while to happen in Westlake and out here because of the limestone. It was hard to get glass through. It was hard to figure out how to mitigate all these rugged areas out here and kind of bringing them into the fold. And so, but as you can see, they weren't afraid to blast. And especially as things had to be on septic systems, you had to anchor that down into, 6 feet of rock. That's an expensive endeavor. There's also caves. There's all kinds of things that were happening there. So three major roads were planted: the Upper Decks on I-35, Mopac, and Loop 360. We'll talk more about Loop 360, and I'll try to keep my own personal feelings reined in somewhat towards that debacle. But so Janet, so they look at this and they say, okay. Development is coming. We have got to get ahead of this. We have to preserve something in our own backyard. Here's this beautiful waterfall. Here's this beautiful creek. And they had met a man who had just done a study for Audubon, identifying it as critical habitat for the endangered golden-cheeked warbler. So, okay, you have a real cause here now. You have, this endangered species to preserve habitat for. We have our own natural heritage to preserve something for. And we want to get ahead of when this big road development comes through. So several things at play. And as I mentioned, Janet loves a list. And in her book, A Snowball Chance of Hell, she makes a list of basically, how do we get this done? And number one was define your cause. And number two was start at the top. for funding. And they threw a proposal out to Texas Parks and Wildlife, and Texas Parks and Wildlife punted it back, and they said, you know, thanks, but y'all really need some federal funding on this. And I'm not going to go super down into the weeds of a lot of the funding stuff because it's very complicated, but and you don't need that granule. But they said, well, federal money, you know, where on earth do you get that? How do you even begin to touch that, you know? And so they said, well, let's call our friend Jake Pickle. This is Jake, and I love this picture. He's handing A.Z. Tyler Morton one of his pickles. That he would hand out all the time. And we have dozens of them still at home. My dad worked for him in full disclosure, and he is the godfather of my oldest brother. And we love Jake. So he tells them about the Land and Water Conservation Fund that had started in 1964. These were big grants that the federal government would send out to the states and said, hey, look, y'all are better at knowing what your, you know, problems are, your issues are, and you know better how to solve them than we do. So we're going to give you pass-through money, and y'all figure out where you want to distribute it throughout the state. And so that goes to Texas Parks and Wildlife. And then it goes out to everybody else, right? And so he basically, and his aide, probably more appropriately, kind of gives them a roadmap on how to ascertain this. And so, but the key was they needed a local municipality to put in the grant request for them. And so first they go to the city of Austin, and the city of Austin was like, sounds a little scary. And then they go to Travis County and they hit a home run. Travis County was starting to think about what parks do we need, how do we get into this preservation and conservation world. They didn't really have too many parks at that point, so they were starting to think about it. And so they became a good ally. And then, and I love this, they took their proposal, somehow they get in contact with this UT student, and he runs it through a computer data, and it comes out and it says, you have a winning project. And so, you know, you gotta go with your wins, right? And so they started moving that forward and getting some of those first funds together. But federal grants and all grants usually need matching funds. And so they started this huge process. And here is where these women's story is different and unique compared to so many other stories that we've looked at and projects that we've looked at around the state. They were fabulous grassroots leaders, par excellent fundraisers, and amazing marketers. Even before marketing was like a big thing, they were fabulous at it. And so these are ladies out shaking the can, as I call it. And, they're volunteers. I wish that there was something, you know, that said who they were. Unfortunately, it's not. A local saloon puts on a music night for them, and that was kind of one of the first times that I'm like, ooh, music can help us kind of in this. Bridge clubs had a party where they, you know, got money together. Scouts, and I told Mom, I remember taking our recycling down and getting the change for it and making a contribution. Scouts would take the recycling down, gather it up, and give that money. There was bake sales and church garage sales. They had a speakers bureau, and I don't remember exactly which person went out to the Rotary Club and gave a fabulous talk, and at the end of it, made an ask. And I think she asked him for $20,000, which was a fairly bold move, but they ended up giving $2,000. They were only going to give $200 because the presentation was so excellent, there was so much passion there, and it really resonated with them. You know, they gave a lot bigger gift than they had originally intended to. This is one of the lists, these are the fundraising basics. If anybody ever wants to know how to fundraise, you can just use this note right here, because it's pretty much it. It's a small piece of paper, and it kind of says it all. So this is where they launched into the grassroots campaign that, to me, as someone who has led a grassroots movement over the past 7 years in Texas, I wish I had their roadmap. I wish I would have read this before, because it really probably would have helped me overcome some hurdles that I had to deal with kind of early on. And but it is, you know, when you look at grassroots movements and what is effective, they had it. And they define the cause, they identify a need. And this is where a lot of people can really relate to endangered species, okay, beautification, okay. Our rural heritage, a thing of our past, that quit. People were moving away from farms, they were moving away from maybe their grandparents had something that they just sold it. They were bringing their kids out here because it had an excellent school system, but also because they could connect with nature. There were still horses around. It was still somewhat rural out here instead of living in suburbia or in, in the city. That just resonated with people. They wanted to save a piece of their past. And that helped propel things as they moved forward. They created a unified message. Save the Wild Basin. Let's save something. That resonates too. And let's do it now or never. Like, all of these terms coming together really created a marketing package that inspired people right away. They engaged thought leaders to spread their message. And not just elected officials. They would meet with, as I mentioned, the Rotary Club, the Garden Clubs, anybody that would listen. And even the what I call the mavens in a community, who were the thought leaders in their own circles. They created actions for volunteers to engage with meaningful achievement. I talked about having the win, the can, turning in some money. That was a win, maybe you want to do it again. And all of the volunteers that came into that could also talk probably in length about that. They had meaningful engagement right off the bat. And Martha, as a recruiter, probably knows better. She would size them up and figure out, what can Barbara do for me? And have a conversation with Barbara. And find out Barbara is really good at, what are you most excellent at?
Relationships,
right. Join me in recruiting. You know, I mean, she would have those conversations and figure out what was meaningful to that person. And all the ladies did as well. Find out what's meaningful to them so that they can plug them into the exact right project to get them to be in there. They replicated those actions, they evaluated them, and they celebrated all of the wins. In the evaluation process, and this is kind of interesting in the documentation, when they very first had, once they formed the Wild Basin, organization, the bylaws were pretty constraining, and they could only raise money and purchase land, if I remember correctly. That was pretty much it. And they realized, we need new bylaws. Now, as somebody who started a nonprofit, changing your bylaws is no fun. It's 0.0 fun. And so, for them to not just kind of go, well, this is what we have, this is how we're going to do it, that wasn't good enough for them. They changed it. They were willing to change. And that willingness to be flexible and change, as it's right here, reserve a bit of flexibility. It's on the list. And so they did, I loved in the description of when they changed their bylaws, it gave them permission to do just about everything but wage war. Is that correct? Yeah. And so that meant that they could build trails. If they wanted to add buildings, they could. They could take tours. So taking the tours, I think, was a catalyst for some of the change, because they didn't have the policies, the insurance that would cover that, and so they needed that flexibility to take the tours out there, especially to inspire donors and teach people about the land and let it be, this living university that they kind of envisioned for it to be. So creating that change. And then celebration was all over the place. This is where the marketing comes in. Austin loves a party, and boy, did it ever in the 70s and early 80s. And if they could come up with a party idea, a fundraising idea, they just went with it. So, and if y'all lived here in the early 70s, you probably remember and probably even went to some of these. Christopher Cross was, he came several times and gave a performance. And I don't think this drawing is done by Ben Sargent, who drew for the Austin Air Force, but several of them were. You know, they got Ben Sargent to draw their drawings for them. You know, they have Esther's Follies here, Asleep at the Wheel. You know, they just, it was however they could slot it in and create some energy and excitement around, and these would be their big fundraisers. And I love it, it's $10 for this whole, you know, this whole bash that's going on here with Christopher Cross, as well as the one with Sleep at the Wheel. Then they got even more elaborate, and somebody donated a boat, a really nice boat, from Bill Gaston Boat Company, which I have no idea if Bill's still in business or not. But I love it. It kind of cut it off, so I'll read this to you because I liked what it said. It says, Wild Basin, which is 4 miles from the capital. It is untouched wilderness. We'd love for it to stay untouched, but to keep the Wild Basin, we have to buy it. And that was in 1977. Price of admission, $1. Did not include barbecue and a chance to win, or did not include the barbecue or the drinks. You had to buy your own on that. So, but $1 got you a chance to win the boat. I didn't find, and Terry, maybe you can find who won the boat. That'd be great to know. Who won the boat? So they also, as they're raising money, again, to get those matching funds, you know, for so many of the bigger grants and stuff, that they're also at the same time looking at and running all the crafts and work for. The Austin American Statesman runs this thermometer, I think it was every week, in the paper.
Yeah.
And, yeah, so I'm getting a yes back here, every week, and it would show where they were on their donation level. You couldn't get the Austin American Statesman to do this today if you paid them $10,000. There's no way. There's no way. And they did it for free. And so in my old job, I worked in the communications divisions for Texas Parks and Wildlife, running the Texas Soil and Nature program. And every time I went to the news division and said, hey, we've got this big conference coming up, you know, do you think we can send a press release out to, you know, the different papers and stuff? Oh, Jen, you know that they don't run anything for you know, conferences or fundraisers and stuff. And I was like, well, they used to. But, yeah, so that's what I'm saying. They just wouldn't do this now, especially every single week. And so building that top-of-the-mind awareness was huge. It was never out of someone's spectrum if they were, you know, reading the paper, listening to the radio. So this one in particular, Robert Redford donates a copy, a signed copy of his script, All the President's Men. And they were going to auction that off. John Denver sends a donated signed bandana. I mean, you know, would you want to win these? Would you pay money for? I don't know, but somebody did. A lot of people did, apparently. And so they were auctioning off at a polo event, of all things. So there's all these, you know, I mean, they just made it work. However, you know, if maybe the polo event was like, hey, we're going to have this. Do you want to be here? Great. Okay, great. Come on. The Highland Park third graders held a bake sale and sold 500 cupcakes, 10 cents each. You know, I mean, this is good stuff. I hope in the archives there are pictures of the fashion shows. Because these are in the 80s, and you know the fashions must have been phenomenal. And I'm sure there's lots of shoulder pads. Probably some hair that kind of went up here. Some nice home perms that we all had. So hopefully those come forward. It mentions them in a newspaper article and in Janet's book. But I haven't found any. If you find any pictures, Terry. Oh, good. Oh, good. Yeah. And then I think one of the most interesting and odd is that Elvis apparently played a concert in Austin shortly before his death. And he slept at the Austin...
Driscoll.
The Driscoll, thank you. And he laid his head on the pillow. And that pillow was given to the ladies to auction off. And so they did it via a radio event that went coast to coast. And not just Austin, but it went coast to coast. This thing was so sensational that they were like, you know, had people bidding all over the place. The DJs loved it. They couldn't talk enough about it. And you know, it seemed like, from what I could see in the archives, you know, they were going crazy for it. So, and here's a great letter, too, that I think I have it. Yeah. This beautiful handwriting, as I mentioned before, is from Margaret and Hessen, and she is writing to say we have another idea. It's not as great as the Elvis pillow, but we want to have a name the dog event, a breeder, a Labrador retriever breeder, gave a dog, and you can name the dog, and then they would auction the dog off. And so this is describing to the radio station what that would look like. Of course, KLBJ picks it up, they run it, they love it, and they auction off the dog. This is a picture of Janet, and you can't see it, unfortunately, cut it off, but there's a little girl in a bunny suit here. They would do a big Easter event, and I'm pretty sure the woman with the blonde curly hair is Carol Keaton Rylander. So everybody, it was a who's look who's list of who was involved. And the result of all this is, yeah, they have the money. They got the money together, and that it was the people's park at that point. Because you gave a dollar, and you gave $10, and, you know, you gave $1,000. Everybody put in. The restaurants would have these cartons out. People would put money into it. There was one story here, I didn't put it in there, but there was a milk carton that was down at a restaurant downtown, if I remember correctly, and it was a bar, tavern, and it hadn't been collected in a while, and the guy was like, hey, you know, you need to come get this. It's quite full. And so they go down, and I love that they described that at that point they were going in pairs to CD things like this, like going to the downtown bar. And they go down into the basement, which is sort of dungeon-esque, and something came alive in the corner. They're not really sure what that was. He goes to the safe, he opens it up, and it is just full of money. And so they quickly take it, and they exit without disturbing whatever was in the corner for too long. And, you know, so everybody had buy-in to this in some sort of way. And it wasn't just, okay, we got some federal monies for it, we got some state monies for it, we got some big donors for it, and end of story. No, it was everybody who had a part in this. And that's what's really unique and different about this story compared to so many others. One last story about the fundraising. They were showing the movie down at Paramount, which would show like first run movies at the time, and I mean second run movies and things like that at the time. And so Janet is down there, she's manning the booth and taking in the donations. And I'm pretty sure she had something more sophisticated than a Folgers coffee can, but she had the money there, and everybody had gone in. And two men walk up and ask how much a ticket is, and she sizes them up, and she thinks they're a little odd. And all of a sudden they throw something in her face, liquid in her face from a cup. And she screams, and the woman from the concession stand runs over and throws water on her. She thought that they had thrown acid in her face when they first did this. And they take the money and they run off. It's $800. And thankfully, it was just ammonia and water, which, so that's not much, you know, that's not great either. You know, she washes off, she's fine. Police come, eventually they catch the guys, and they fine them $800 each. So Janet turns this into a win of $800. And thankfully the judge also helped him out with that too. But, you know, I mean, that's, you know, you're out there and raising money, you've got a bunch of cows sitting there, and but it didn't deter her at all. Throughout all of this, it wasn't the fun stories, you know, I mean, I described a lot of fun stories, but there were obstacles. There were plenty of them. They have 15 different pieces of property that they had to purchase. Some of those landowners were fine. Some of them were not fine. The city's parks department was always hit or miss, always kind of hot and cold, but they would give a lot of lip service. Saying, you know, oh, we support this, we support this, we support this. But then behind it, they were kind of running some of their other programs, and they didn't want to contribute to it. And so that was always kind of going on. So they never really knew where they stood with them. It was a little contentious over there. And then comes this county audit. So at this point, Ann Richards is the county commissioner. But along the way, there was so much trust in what these women were doing, and there was so little capacity at the county to be able to really do all of this, especially to mitigate the sale and purchase of 15 different properties. They gave the women power to say, they had their own board of directors, and they said, look, y'all just deal directly with the comptroller. And if you need to, you know, involve us, but let us know what's going on. But you take charge, and you really, you know, do what you need to do. Well, one of the county commissioners got a little sideways, and he wanted things maybe done his way. We'll leave it at that. And so he suggests that they get an audit, and they do. In everything, there's something good, right? So Ann Richards looks at the audit, and normally had an auditor come in, and the county doesn't have their records. They have to go to another entity to ascertain those records. And they would have normally shut that down. But because what they got was so perfectly organized, everything was done above the board, everything was done legally, there was plenty of documentation, they said, okay, great, well, what can we do? And so Ann set a path forward, and she designated a person to help out, and they were able to move forward at that point. Like I said, normally auditor would just shut that down. Kiki is here, who works for Texas Parks and Wildlife. You know, if there's an audit and you get one little ding, you better not do that ever again. You know, the audit actually came as something good. It made the county have more buy-in. It made the county really put this in the front of what they were doing, and all of the commissioners and the judge have more say in this. And I think in the end, this was a good thing. I'm sure while they were living it, it was probably no fun, because as you know, the audit is zero fun. And then, so they get the land, the majority of the land set aside. You know, again, they're working. They think they've, you know, kind of got it all set aside. They hire David Mahler, who's here in the picture. They hire a programs director, and then later he becomes an executive director. But Luke 360 is coming, and this is my term. The eco-apocalypse is on its way. Loop 360, the way that it was built, it's a disaster. It cuts right through the peninsula of West Bay. It goes right through Gold Chief Warbler habitat. It crosses several creeks that, you know, it really damaged along the way. And when it came to Bee Creek, instead of putting a bridge, they just put these huge culverts that are there. You would never know that they're there if you're just driving down Loop 360, but in there, they were so big, I could ride my pony through them, and of course I did. And I didn't have to duck. I mean, there are these huge culverts that are there. But they didn't do it right. They did it haphazardly. Janet and all the ladies were raising the flag, raising the flag, raising the flag. Audubon, everybody was saying, no, don't do it like this. Build a bridge like you're going to build over Bull Creek. You know, do this differently. Well, because they were kind of mad, TxDOT, they kind of did it quick. And as y'all know, when they do things quick, it's not always right. And so they knew that there was going to be a lot of runoff coming into the creek. Very soon after they put them in, the Memorial Day flood happens. And all of this runoff goes down into the creek. It fills some of the ponds and stuff that are there. But it makes it all the way down to the Colorado River. And this, again, is where a win happens. Here comes all this caliche dumping out into the Colorado River. And that sent up red flags. Everybody's like, wait, where is this coming from? What is this? And so finally, they get TxDOT to put in some gabion screenings, which is rock with wire over top of it. And they finally plant some native plants along the banks. But at that point, the damage is done. And I think probably Terry and Barbara and everybody that works at the Wild Basin can still say that they're probably still, you know, getting some of that scar, parts of it still cleaned up. At this point, they don't own the waterfall yet. Is that correct? The waterfall is still one of the piece of properties that they have not been able to secure. And he was one of the people, a man named Robert Brandis, did not want to sell. And finally, and this is a very contentious part of the Wild Basin's history, but he doesn't want to sell at any price. Whatever price they name, he goes higher. He shows up to county commissioner meetings and is very contentious. And so finally, Ann Richards decides that really the citizens of Austin are not going to forgive them for creating this park, but not having the very best piece to it. It's the jewel. It's the crown jewel of this whole thing. And it was the whole reason they started down this path in the beginning, right? And we see those beautiful pictures of the waterfall. And so they take it by eminent domain, and which is, you know, you never want to go there. That's how they did it. And then that's how the LCRA gets involved. LCRA helps put up some of the last money to be able to purchase that. Even though this happened in 1983, I think because of lawsuits, it didn't come in for quite a while. Is that right? Yeah, it was still being contested for quite a long time. But at least they had it in process and they secured it. Another thing's happening in 1983 that Brandis really, he made out like a bandit, because in 83 the bust was coming and land values were starting to plummet. Land values were plummeting everywhere except for along the speculation of Loop 360. It was one of the biggest areas that they had just, you know, things had skyrocketed. I remember at one point there was a U-totem that was at the corner of B Caves and 360, and we would ride our horses down there to get a Coke and stuff. And it was the busiest convenience store in the state of Texas because of all the construction workers that were there buying things. The old U-totem. So, and Mom, I don't know if you want to add anything about that track or.
I'll just mention real fast that having succeeded later as a county commissioner doing the Balcones County lands, we inherited Robert Brandis, who was very opposed to any such thing because he had fought the Wild Basin so hard. And he would come every week and protest and talk about how we shouldn't be having preserves. But it also made the commitment that the county made, it wasn't just for Robert, but kind of a community commitment that there would never be eminent domain used for the Balcones Canyon lands because of the bad feelings that had come off the Brandis fight, which was a knockdown drag out. But, so when you go and look at that waterfall, realize the effort it took, and thank Ann Richards and the commissioner's court for being willing to go fight for it. But it did have a lasting effect, but it was okay. The Balcones have made it quite well without eminent domain, 33,000 acres now. So.
Yeah, thank you. And so this is the legacy. It's 227 acres of natural heritage. It has 2.5 miles of trails. Mentioned earlier, it's a place for research and for education. And it's a launching point for many careers. Kiki started there. Terry started there. I have a whole list of people that I've worked with throughout the years who started at the Wild Basin. And so it really is a place for learning and something unique and special to us here. This is the full title of the book. I just had to put it in here somewhere. It's A Snowball's Chance in Hell, How Seven Little Old Ladies in Tennis Shoes Whipped the Establishment and Created an Urban Nature Preserve.
Wow.
And that's exactly what they did. I mean, you're going to title a book something, title it what you did, right? And how can you help? So before I go a little bit into how can you help, they preserve something that is unique and special to Westlake and to the West Bank area. And all of you are in this room because you have some sort of connection to it, right? And whether you've hiked there, maybe it was 20 years ago, or you were there just a couple days ago, it's in our own backyard. It's ours. I bet people in this room, like I said, have even contributed to it. The business community contribute to it. The schools all raise money for it. There's a whole wave of children that got out there and had, you know, some sort of bake sale or, you know, something for it. And at that point, we were the next generation. I point to myself at that point, Nicole, and you were probably there as well. Now we have to think about the next generation, right? And what are they getting out of it? And how are they participating with it? How many school kids go through there a year, do you think?
Right now, about
1,600 school kids every single year.
Unguided
tours. It's right in our backyard. How about 5,000? How about 10,000? How about that be used every single day by our school systems as a place for learning and connecting with the outdoors? This is something I'm crazy passionate about, but you know, that's why I was part of the Texas Soil and Nature, the director for 7 years for that. They need your help. I put this picture in here because this is what the page looks like that I took the picture from earlier. It's in those old scrapbooks. It's hard to peel anything out of. And as Barbara mentioned before, you know, there's all these wonderful archives that are there. That tells our history, our story, right? And it would be great to have them archived in a better solution for that, whether they're digitized, copied, whatever it is. In talking to them, after looking at some of those, we're looking at about $75,000 for them. And that's a big ask, but I think it's worth it. And certainly, if y'all want to do something for the Wild Basin, I didn't bring a can, but you can talk to Barbara if there's something that you want to do for them. They're also about to launch into a big campaign to renovate the, if you don't mind me saying so, the education center, so that it can have better capacity and come up to speed. So I do hope that you think about this as part of your natural and cultural heritage and want to do something for them. So I don't get anything from me asking for them, that's the best thing about that. So you are welcome to ask me questions, but Martha is here, my mom is here, Barbara, Terry, there's so many people in this room that probably would have better answers for you. This is being recorded, so if you're okay with that, if you're having your answers recorded, I just want to make you aware of that. So if you don't want something on record, Maybe don't say that. Thank you all.